Hi, I'm Dennis Stovall, and I'm the director of the publishing program at Portland State University, from which I'm soon to retire. And I'm also a publisher of Hooligan Press, which is the student-run laboratory for that program. I have a history in writing, publishing, and literary activism.
And recently
I received a Fulbright, which I will be spending in several trips to Europe over the next 3 to 4 years to consult with universities there that are interested in implementing publishing programs similar to this one. What we've created here is something that is unique internationally. Nowhere else is there a program that teaches publishing this current with all of the latest ways of doing this, and that has the students actually participants in their own education in a way of not just supplication, but of activism. So when I talked about myself as a literary activist and a publisher, in fact, that's some of what I've tried to teach, is that if you care about words and you care about writing and publishing, then you need to pursue that passionately as a social activity and even as a political activity. And that publishing and writing are really part of a large community of the printed word that includes so many more people than I think we generally understand. So it's not just the writers, it's not just the publishers, or not just the subdivisions of labor within those things, but it's the librarians, the school teachers, the booksellers. All of those people are actually part of this, and anybody who's serious about publishing should be organizing all of them together. Well, it's probably worth saying that we're in the midst of probably the most incredible changes in publishing and writing now that any of us have seen in our lifetime. And what that's left open are amazing opportunities, because there's such ambiguity. So publishing is reinventing itself.
Wow.
I mean, we can nail the division of labor that's going to be there and has been there, the editorial, marketing, and design sides of things. But the production of the book, the tangible form of it, has shifted amazingly fast. And so digital reproduction, but the possibility of incredibly short runs that allow books to stay in print now when they used to go out of print regularly, allows experimentation that we have not seen, I think, probably in 50 years.
Wow.
Because frankly, what we've suffered over the last several decades has been a forced commoditization of the book and of literature, as the big box stores and even Amazon have forced everybody to pay attention to only what sells.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the exigencies of producing books in the old manner meant that you had to invest only in the books that you knew could make money, because you had to survive. And that eliminated the experimentation that informs the literary center of our culture, keeps it vibrant by always bringing in that new feed.
Also,
suddenly that was gone.
A lot of writers who were very successful who suddenly found themselves flatlisted.
Well, you know, they said, yeah, that was part of it. But for people who are looking at this and don't understand how the book industry has worked, there's always been this potential for the return of your books when they sold. And that meant that when an author's sales fell below some threshold that a larger publisher wanted to sustain for the sake of profit, their books were abandoned. The publisher, of course, never said, oh, it's our fault that the book didn't sell well. It was always laid on the author for it having not performed. But there was something else that happened probably about, 30 years ago nearly now, when there was an interesting tax decision called the Thor Tool Machine decision. Thor Tool Machine decision. And it was really aimed at manufacturers who were trying to write off obsolete inventory, but it had this enormous impact on publishers, because we're also manufacturers.
Oh.
And it created the remainder industry. But at the time that it created the remainder industry, we also were seeing the emergence of the big box stores, certainly the malling of America and the mall stores. And that already was skewing the kinds of books that would appear in the bookstore and how long they would stay on the shelves. So that tax decision, along with those market changes, took away the incentive for older books to be kept in print. And there really was a time where an author could approach a publisher, an established publisher, and have a voice recognized, but be seen also as a writer who was learning the tricks of the trade. And that writer would be given the voice, would be put into print, and it was a bet that that writer by the third book or the fourth book would make money. But suddenly everything shifted, and now books had to be responsible for profits immediately out of the gate. And that forced a lot of books to either not be published, and particularly it forced all of those books that were in backlist, that used to be the gold mine for most publishing houses, to be further marginalized and then abandoned to remaindering in order to get the capital back out of them and to avoid the tax consequences. So what we're seeing now in this really exciting, vibrant period is a revival of experimentation. And we were seeing that, I think, in some areas. For instance, poetry has had a really huge revival because of a new oral tradition. Voice and sound poetry, for instance, which was not getting a play, for one thing. It didn't work well in most books. But now, transformed by multimedia, has an opportunity to be published in a number of forms, integrated forms.
If we can just take a moment to go back to where you started. Mm-hmm. Where'd you grow up?
I grew up in the Dalles, Oregon, which is on the Columbia River, about 80 miles east of Portland, high desert. And grew up in a really literate family. My mother and my dad, who moved to the Dalles in 1951-52, right in that neighborhood, were labor radicals and quite literate working class intellectuals. The house was so full of books that there was really no room to do much of anything else. My two brothers and I'm the eldest of the three, were not just readers from the beginning, but we were avid book collectors, and there were no strictures placed on what we could read or could not read. No censorship whatsoever. And so there would be five of us in the living room, with the television on, by the way, reading.
Yeah.
And talking about what we were reading.
Is there any particular book or author that you think back, I was, you know, in fourth grade or second grade or 12 years old, whatever, that it just...
Well, The Wizard of Oz was probably the first book. I read it when I first learned to read, so I was four and a half. And that was magical. For one thing, it was my graduation from kids' books. And I had the self-confidence, and my parents gave me the encouragement to go ahead and just tackle that book. And I read it. And that opened not just the possibilities of literature, but it told me I could read anything, and I could get to it. So that was enormously exciting. It did backfire on me, by the way, though. When I was in the first grade teacher in the first week of school asked everybody in the class to bring the last book they had read. And I brought that book, and she accused me in front of the class of lying. I could not have read that book because
right.
I was too young.
Too young, yes.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, that's...
My parents, of course, were on her like a rug.
Right.
You know, growing up in the... being a child of the 60s, of course, has certain advantages. Being the child of labor radicals had advantages and disadvantages. But in the Dalles, there were probably 15 of us who became the late blooming beatniks and too early to be hippies group, all of whom thought that we were going to be literary stars of one sort or another. Interestingly, among that group, I thought everybody else would succeed and be and have a life in literature, and I'm the only one.
Hmm.
I didn't have the confidence at that point to be a writer, and I don't want to blame my teachers for that, but their lack of understanding about what all of the writing possibilities might be left them creating this option that looked like three flavors of ice cream, you know, the strawberry, vanilla, and chocolate of writing. You could become a journalist and be a dissipated alcoholic. You could become a poet and be really poor alcoholic. You could become a novelist and just, you know, because of lack of success, drink yourself to death. So it was like, you know, there really wasn't much potential there. So what I did was keep the writing for the things that I was doing in support of whatever that might be and my personal diaries. But it never occurred to me that it was possible to make a living as a writer, that there were too few options. So it wasn't until I had left town, gone away to university and seen a broader range of writing possibilities, and then because of the politics of that period began being a political writer and a political publisher, that I realized that there really were opportunities. But it was still the thing that seemed to me to be impossible as a basis for making a living. I learned later that it's the easiest way.
How did you get into publishing?
Well, that was the result of doing contract work. In my radical stuff out of the University of Oregon, the time when I was active in SDS, and when I published a labor newspaper, and during the actual student movement, a group of us had bought a huge old offset press and set it up. We had to extend the garage on a house. The thing was probably 80 feet long, and cast iron, many tons actually. But we figured out how to run stuff on that, and I became a printer. We were running broadsides and newspapers, so I became a printer, learned how all of that was done, at the same time that I was editing a newspaper and writing probably a half to two-thirds of what was in that newspaper, but editing other people. That was a little bit different than working on books, of course, and the books came later. I had spent time as a union organizer, and during that time I always wrote for whatever organizing campaign was going on. I always gave away what I wrote, and decided that because the economy was tanking and labor was getting quiet, that if there was ever an opportunity to get into writing full-time, I better take it. And Lenny, my wife, who was also a labor organizer, both of us were working in the steel mills in Pittsburgh at the time, when I came home and told her that I thought I wanted to write full-time and that I would need her support, said, okay, 1 year on the condition that you quit smoking. Impossible to turn down. And I had failed at quitting many times before, but that one worked. That absolutely worked. But I was so naive about what it meant still. And I thought that I could set off and spend 6 or 8 months studying how to write novels and become a novelist and make money. And when it was pretty clear that that wasn't going to work out, especially when her mill closed and I suddenly had to make a living, I started to flail and look around at other ways to put together a writing life. And at that point, I started to realize that the ubiquity of writing was really the way to understand the opportunities in writing. Somebody gets paid to put the words even on the grocery store bag. And that was a revelation. I mean, it wasn't what I desired to do. Well, when I started doing the ghostwriting and realized that this was an opportunity for me to learn voice, to learn how to structure a long document, how to tell a story, how to understand the difference between biography, autobiography, and memoir, I also discovered that it was an excellent way to learn how to do books, because every one of the clients I got wanted the book published at the end. And while very few of them had books that had any commercial possibility, almost all of them had some sort of personal or business possibility. And I had to spec the paper, do the type, you know, judge the type and design, find the printers and the binders. And it was such a wonderful experience. I enjoyed it so much. And I thought, this is one of the things I want to do. But it wasn't one of the things that was on my agenda quite then. I used that period, though, several years to really refine my writing and to get it to the point where I was making a really solid living, and then moved back to the West Coast, moved home. Of course, what appears to be a transportable occupation always turns out to be more dependent than you thought on locality. So I had to make new connections when I got here, and in the course of doing that, created a book called Writer's Northwest Handbook. This is probably 1982. It was from the list of all of the possible places to publish, from trade publications to the newsstand stuff. And other writers began asking me for my list. I figured, well, if they want it, why don't I just package it and sell it? So I did that book and created a publishing company called Media Weavers that did that, and seduced Lenny into joining me in that. She was head of the media project, which represented the film and video artists in the Northwest. So I got her into publishing, and together we did that book every 2 years for about 10 years before selling the project. But we also did a quarterly newspaper called Writers Northwest, a tabloid, that wound up having a readership in the region of about 75,000. So at the time that we were doing that, it was probably the third largest circulation writing publication in the country. Wow. And that supplemented the handbook, but the two of them allowed us to become the nexus for communication within the broad literary community in the Northwest. And we substituted ourselves, frankly, for the Arts Commissions. not just because we were activists and community and labor organizers and had the organizing tools, but because we saw a vacuum. We didn't feel like the arts commissions integrated the broad community of the printed word well within their own bailiwicks, let alone across the state lines. So we began pushing out, and it didn't take very long before the arts agencies in Oregon, Washington, Idaho, Montana, and Alaska, and to some extent British Columbia, recognized what we were doing and began approaching us to give us grants, even though we weren't nonprofit, to go out and do what they consider to be community service. So this is where the literary activism really took off. By the time we sold that project, everything was flowing through our office in the region that had to do with anything, because we had announcements every month. All of that was there. And this was just ahead of the web. Mm-hmm. In fact, had we not sold that project, we would have migrated that entire thing to the web almost immediately, because it's the perfect sort of renewable resource to do there.
Right. You've addressed two distinct worlds, the world of writing and the world of publishing, although they obviously overlap.
Mm-hmm.
There's a third world that I have not heard you mention at all, agents.
Certainly. Well, if anyone is up against the wall for adapting to change right now, it's agents. And I think that most of them who have survived over the last 5 to 10 years to tell the tale have already figured out how to do that. That they're really becoming arts and rights managers as opposed to being simply author representatives.
Can we go arts and rights managers?
Managers, yes. And they're also developers in a way that they never were in the past. I mean, their role was to winnow and to recognize the best and pass it on. It was not to find the editor to do the editing, because the assumption was that the publisher would assume the responsibility. But in fact, that's been abrogated by most publishers. They expect now that agents, as a certain level of gatekeeper or filterer, mediator, what else? I mean, there are a number of different terms we could use here, will be the ones who make sure the work is almost ready for copy editing. Maybe substantive editing will have already been done. And in some cases, they would prefer that most of the copy editing be done and that they can move right to proofing. So that wasn't something that most agents were either trained to do, or if they were trained to do, had left in order to be agents because they didn't want to do it anymore. And they've had to find new roles in doing that. They've also had to figure out how, when there are fewer and fewer opportunities to get big advances out of large publishers, they move into the realm of selling to smaller publishing houses where there's likely no advance, but those ongoing small tributary streams of income from the actual books. Now, there are clearly disadvantages because you have to maintain a lot of relationships for those small streams. But there is a distinct advantage, and that is that small and mid-sized publishers will keep the books in print longer, and those small streams will add up to larger streams over time, just not in big chunks. So they've had to shift the focus there, and they've also begun working in the realm of e-books, where they're finding that they're working with a new kind of literature. They're no longer selling 100,000 word books. They're selling 20,000 to 40,000 word books, because the media itself has begun to change the notion of story and what's an acceptable package for a story. So for instance, for us as publishers, we've stopped thinking of the book as a book, but we start thinking of the vessel that contains the story. And the vessel can take many forms. Well, agents, like publishers, now have to look at everything that comes in terms of which of these vessels is the best one for delivering the goods to the appropriate audience. And there was a disconnect in the past. An agent might recognize good work, but it was left entirely up to the publisher to make the connection with the audience. Now there's a broad and long collaboration involved in making a book work. And that, I think, works to the advantage of readers, certainly, because we're getting, as I mentioned before, newer, riskier, more inventive work, because you can do it in short form. But certainly for the writers, you know, there's a chance to do that piece that you never thought would sell.
Yeah. Right. Where do you think this is going to be in 10, 12, 15?
I mean, it really is wild-ass guessing, but one of the things I expect to see is that more and more multimedia pieces are done that could not be translated to traditional book form. It's fairly easy to take traditional books and move them into new media, but that's flat. And the opportunity is for a different kind of topology, you might say, in what we do, because we can integrate sound, we can jump and hop around, we can engage the audience in the authorship of work, which is one of the interesting things that's happening. We see collaborative writing, we see the never-ended, never-finished work that nevertheless is satisfying because it's incomplete. We also see opportunities, and this is a little time-bound to say this. There's a wonderful Corning Glass piece on YouTube called "A Day in Glass" or "Day in the Life of Glass," that looks at what the glass technology that all of us have now on our iPhones and iPads and other touch-sensitive screens extrapolated. So that it becomes the wall of the house, the front of the refrigerator, the mirror in the bathroom, and where your text actually appears there and where you can manipulate it and look at it and integrate graphics in it. Now, in a lot of the shift that we're seeing now, we see the gratuitous addition of new media to old media as if that was going to be the zippy new thing. In fact, most of that is just canning crap and adding it at the end. Really, what has to be looked at is how a new work comes in and can fit with all of these possibilities thoughtfully from the very beginning, from acquisition, not adding on bits and pieces like author interviews and calling that an enhancement. That's not an enhancement, that's an author interview. Yeah. So I see the means of storytelling expanding the possibilities for story. I see stories flourishing in media where people didn't expect to tell them. That is, not just in the realm of the web and e-books, but these hybrid things.
So you're confident that storytelling in its many shapes and forms, from the writing to the publishing to the distribution, is a vibrant industry that will continue?
Absolutely.
Yeah?
In fact, it is quite frankly thriving. It's not the big guys who have sorted things out, because for them it's commoditization, it's monetization, it's control of intellectual property. And they're going to make some of the same mistakes tripping over themselves that the music industry has made. But even the ones who adapt best to it are still merely going to be the giants. What the new technologies have suddenly offered is opportunity for the little guy to come in. And so the social side of publishing, and there's always been this sort of the notion of the social side because of the connection of author-reader, is now really a social activity among many of the new publishers who I know.
I mean, you filled 60 minutes of tape with brilliance.
Well, I don't know about brilliance, but you can get
okay,
more.
Okay, 59 minutes of it is brilliant.
Okay,
but
59, okay.
You've been incredible.
Yeah.
I mean, this has been really valuable, and it's one of the things we're hoping to find is, as we're doing this, is not just that it's about writing, it's about communicating.
Yes, stories.
Yeah. Thanks.
You're
great.
Welcome.
It's awesome.
Yeah.